What's going on, Purple Night Nation? This is Munch on the mic, and today I have a treat with you. Today I'm interviewing Mr. Lois Eric Eli. He's a writer and a filmmaker. He was born in New Orleans, and his career started as a reporter for the Atlantic Journal-Constitution. He was then a manager for a few jazz musicians, and then in 1995, he was a reporter for the Times-Picayune. He has three books, including the Treme Stories and Recipes from the Heart of New Orleans. He has a few novels and articles in the Oxford American. His work also appears in the Gourmet, the Washington Post, the New York Times, Bon Appetit, Downbeat, and the San Francisco Chronicle. Most recently, he joined the writing staff for the Amazon series The Man in the High Castle. Before that, he wrote for the OWN TV show series Green and the HBO series Treme. He also wrote the PBS documentary Fanberg Treme, The Untold Story of Black New Orleans. And his essay, America Greatest Hit, is also included in the Best African American Essays in 2009. Thank you for joining us today, Mr. Eli. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. I'm not going to complain.
So, thinking back to your high school days, did you initially have a lot of writing experience, or was that a passion that you developed over time?
I always enjoyed writing, and it came relatively easy to me, which is not to say it was easy to write well, but it was easy to at least, you know, sort of be competent. But I went to New Orleans Center for Creative Arts to study jazz guitar there. So I got sidetracked from writing, did that, then went to college to study business, and then didn't return to writing until after that, when I went to journalism school and worked at the Atlanta Journal-Constitution.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the formative years of your career and what inspired you to go into journalism?
My father was a civil rights lawyer, and my mother was also very interested in, my mother was a teacher, then counselor, then principal, so she's always very interested in social issues. And what I liked about writing was it's the intersection of art and activism. If you write about important things, or if you write in such a way to talk about your community and perhaps encourage action on the part of people, those are two things that are important to me. So that's so the intersection that I was working from.
So what prompted you to create and write the PBS documentary, The Untold Story of Black New Orleans? And why was it an important story for you to tell?
The idea for that project came from Dawn Logsdon, and her father was a historian at the University of New Orleans, and he and Arnold Hirsch co-edited a book called Creole New Orleans, Race and Americanization. And that book looked at the kind of Creole political tradition, and Creole in that sense loosely meant people who were speaking French or Spanish at the time of the American Purchase, meaning people who had some experience or some roots in pre-American New Orleans. So what we wanted to do was talk about the extent to which New Orleans had been politically radically, or Black New Orleans had been politically radical, even prior to the Civil War. And so that was the genesis of it. She came and asked me if I'd be a part of it. I signed on, and we created the documentary.
How did you take the leap from journalism and writing to television and screenwriting?
Eric Overmyer and David Simon created this show called Treme. They were both big fans of New Orleans music and of the city in general. So they had this idea that they wanted to do a show about the city and its culture. And so they had some TV writers they were used to working with, but they also wanted to get a couple of folks who were not necessarily TV writers, but who knew the city and were writers. So they hired me and Tom Piazza. And after one season, they asked me to come back and work full time on the show. And this was in, what year was it? Wow, I guess 2008. At that point, the Times-Picayune was offering buyouts. Things in the newspaper industry were not looking good, and newspapers were downsizing, losing circulation, losing revenue. So it was a good time to jump into television, because television was also in the ascendant. You know, there were more and more shows, more and more networks, more and more possibilities. So working in TV was sort of like the brave new world.
Both of your parents had very successful careers. Your father was a civil rights attorney, and your mother was the school principal and a university professor. Are there any particular lessons that they've taught you?
Yeah. Where do we begin? You know, my father's attitude about the civil rights movement was that it needed to be about the average Black person. And he had a kind of contempt and disdain for most Black politicians and mainly the leaders of the contemporary civil rights organizations, because they seem more interested in what is possible for their personal advancement or for the advancement of middle-class Black people at the expense of the people who put their lives and livelihoods on the line to make the movement possible. So I share his concern in that regard. And that to me is the big lesson of his life. My mother was the first person in her immediate family to go to college. And so she always worked very hard to try to keep the students that she was teaching public school to go into college. To finish school and do well. And she's a principal at Lusher Elementary School. She worked hard to ensure that Black kids would be there and be successful alongside the white children who are generally the sons and daughters of Loyola and Tulane professors. So it is sensed that poor Black folks deserved as much of the American pie as anybody else was crucial to the way that both of them viewed the world. And that's very much the way I view the world.
So your father represented protesters and core activists, but he also represented the first Black mayor of New Orleans. What influence did that experience have on you and your career writing your stories?
My father and Dutch Morio were very different men. And so that was sort of heroic in the sense that he and Dutch managed to figure out how to get Dutch into the state legislature through that legal action. But they were not close and they were divergent in terms of their sense of what was important in terms of their method. So to be honest, that didn't have any influence on me at all.
Well, your work has appeared in The Gourmet, The Washington Post, The New York Times, Bon Appetit, and your writing brings people together from history, food, and culture. How did you come up with the idea to combine all of these works, work aspects into one?
There's an aspect of this that goes back to my parents and grandparents. Both of my grandmothers scrubbed floors for a living. And so there was a kind of respect for that work and those women, which I was raised to always have. The other thing is that while Black Americans have often sought to ensure that everybody go to college and get a professional career so that they could be respected, what we miss is that our real contributions in this country have been cultural. So, you know, I'm glad we got Black doctors and Black lawyers, and they have been crucial. But in terms of cultural contributions, you can't have American music without Black folks. You can't have American fashion, American dance, American food without Black folks. So I always understood food to be political. And Rudy Lombard, in his book, Creole Feast, 15 Master Chefs in New Orleans Reveal Their Secrets, I worked not on the book, but I worked on the food festival that came out of that book. When I say worked on it, I was in high school, so worked on it meant, you know, running around and doing that kind of thing. But I always knew that food was political and that we had to engage it in that way. And so in writing about food, I was always writing about culture and politics. Food is only one part of it. And I think people often miss that. Taste of the food is crucial, but there's so many other things, whether we're talking about race relations, ethnic and national origins of food, or even our connection to the women who made food for us growing up.
So New Orleans does not have a lot of barbecue tradition, yet you wrote 3 books about barbecue. Where did this interest spark?
I was working with Wynton Marcellus, and Frank Stewart, a great photographer, was also working on a book with Wynton, and he He and I became good friends, and he grew up in Memphis and Chicago. So he suggested doing a book on barbecue. And I wrote a book proposal, which was pretty generic and pretty bad, to be honest. But then we went on the road. We went to Memphis, and I wrote a sample chapter. And that's when I figured out what the book was going to be about. I understood the barbecue both reflected and was a reflection of American culture and all the big themes of America in terms of race relations, ethnic relations, regional differences and similarities. All of these things come together in barbecue. And so it was not my intention to write a bunch of stuff about barbecue. But then when the Southern Foodways Alliance did the second volume of its Cornbread Nation anthology of Southern food writing, they asked me to edit it. And then Rodney Scott, a pit master out of South Carolina, who got a James Beard Award a couple of years ago, when he got ready to write his book, he called on me because I knew about the South Carolina barbecue tradition from my own book. And so, you know, he thought I'd be a good person to write that book with him. And that's what I've been doing for the last, I guess, year and a half.
So I am a recent graduate and I'm wrapping up my high school career. I was a part of the St. Augustine Film and Media team for over 7 years, and I'm very interested in continuing my studies in media arts. What advice can you give students like me?
Read and watch everything you can. It's very difficult now because these days folks don't do a whole lot of reading. And I think all of us attempted to only read and watch and discuss the things that seem most directly relevant to us or the things that our peers are checking out. You got to venture far wider than that, man. Don't just watch and read the things that are most comfortable or most related to you. Check out everything. Living in Los Angeles, you talk to young people whose knowledge of film history and of television history is encyclopedic and impressive. And you got to do that. You also got to always be aware that there's a larger world beyond whatever your world is. So beyond St. Aug, beyond Clark Atlanta, beyond New Orleans, beyond Atlanta. And you got to figure out how to be in dialogue with that world. So as an example, Atlanta is now a big hub of production because of the state tax credits. But the truth is that film is still headquartered in Los Angeles, and television media is still headquartered in New York. So don't think that everything is in Atlanta just because a lot of things are in Atlanta. Always be looking at the bigger world.
Thank you. Could you tell us some new projects you are currently working on?
You know, in the television business, either you're working on a show or you're working on a script to create a new show. So I got a couple of possibilities that I'm playing with. There's a graphic novel called The Nye Chronicles about a woman who's abducted by UFOs and is very influenced by that experience. So some producers came to me to write about that. And so we're trying to create a show based on that. I'm also very interested in Minneapolis, even before George Floyd and his death or his murder, which is so encapsulated the nation, so riveted the nation. Minneapolis is so viewed as a typical white American city with Scandinavian roots because so many people from Norway and Sweden moved there. But quietly, it has become a real hub of immigrant activity. And I've never been to Somalia, I've been to a lot of places in East Africa. So the idea of a show about a Somali immigrant family in Minneapolis interests me. So that's the main project I'm working on now.
Okay. Thank you. It was a pleasure and an honor to talk to you today.
Hey, good luck to you. And, you know, check in with me from time to time. Maybe I can give you some advice or help you out in some way. I'd be glad to.
That would be fantastic.